Hello, everyone, and welcome to Advising for Future Ready Careers. My name is Kelsey Kamen, and I am the Program Manager for NCWIT Counselors for Computing. It is my pleasure to bring you episode 7 of this webinar series hosted by NCWIT Counselors for Computing. Each month, we will connect you with thought leaders at the cutting edge of technology. This series offers a unique opportunity to dive into the intersection of computer science with traditional and non-traditional STEM fields, also known as CS plus X. Throughout the presentation, we'd love for you to submit questions using the Q&A feature. It's on the bottom of your toolbar, at the bottom of your screen. We'll also be sharing resources in the chat feature, which can also be found on the toolbar at the bottom of your screen. The National Center for Women and Information Technology, or NCWIT, is a nonprofit community of more than 1,400 universities, companies, nonprofits, and government organizations nationwide. NCWIT equips change leaders with resources for taking action in recruiting, retaining, and advancing women across the entire computing ecosystem. Before NCWIT, programs focusing on women in computing existed mostly in isolation, without the benefit of shared practices, effective resources, communication with others, or national reach. Today, these programs are part of the NCWIT community, creating a far greater impact than if institutions acted alone. Counselors for Computing is one of the programs in the NCWIT K-12 Alliance. So NCWIT Counselors for Computing, or C4C, provides information and resources that help counselors in the front line of the computing conversation. We bring people and programs together with professional development, knowledge, and resources to give all students access to transformative computing careers. And we wouldn't be here today without the support of our sponsor, the Department of Defense STEM, the largest employer of scientists, engineers in the nation. DoD STEM offers educational programs, internships, and scholarships for students, and many career development opportunities for educators. DoD's STEM's goals are to attract, inspire, and develop exceptional STEM talent across the education continuum and advance the current DoD STEM workforce to meet future defense technological challenges. There are opportunities for all areas of interest, and many do not require active military duty. These opportunities include working in research labs, human resources, finance, and more. And we've shared their website in the chat for you to learn more. It is now my pleasure to introduce our speaker, Chris Carruth. Hi, Chris. So to tell you a little bit about Chris is an interdisciplinary artist, educator, and technologist who has taught at the University of Colorado for many years and is ranked among the university's top educators by FCQ, ultimately winning the prestigious Marinus Smith Award for Outstanding Teaching. At its core, his research is focused on the social, emotional, and existential impacts of technology on contemporary life. As a practice, he intervenes in these dynamics, exploring the roles embodied experience, participatory engagement, indigenous wisdom, and the desire to express, having constructing knowledge, connecting to self, and reimagining future potential. Deeply rooted in the American tradition of on-the-road documentation, photography is the common medium of his practice, yet he relies on a range of professional and consumer-grade lens-based media, creative coding, poetics, sound, net art, archival content, and new media to weave together personal narrative, philosophical inquiry, investigative journalism, and playful curiosity. Chris is currently rostered as teaching faculty within information sciences at CU Boulder, and we'll put Chris's email in the chat if you'd like to connect. Please enjoy this presentation from Chris Carruth about the intersection of computer science and art.
Okay, right into it without any preamble. This right here is Jean-Francois Millet's The Gleaners from 1857, as you see in the title there. Millet was a realistic painter. He painted realism. He painted reality with an exacting detail, as you can see from this painting the gleaners. Gleaners, if you're not familiar with the term, it is someone who scavenges or harvests from the land. So after a landowner would harvest a crop, there would be a few remnants left over, things that had little value, small potatoes, small tubers, small vegetables, or just the forgotten leftover. Gleaners would go out there and sift through and keep what was left. So the social commentary in this picture, but more important to our conversation today, is the fact that this was the height of realism in painting at the time. So this is what painters would strive for throughout the course of a career, a lifetime even. And this work would be the culmination of months, if not years, worth of effort to draw and then paint what you see here. So 1857, height of realism. This was the state of the art at that point in time. Now, two decades, more or less, before this, you had this dapper-looking gentleman, Louis Daguerre. Louis Daguerre developed the device on the right there, the daguerreotype. The daguerreotype can rightly be thought of as the precursor to the modern camera, whether that's analog or digital. And that camera accomplished what Francois Millet and his contemporaries were trying to do only through a chemical process. Instead of taking a lifetime or at least several months to get something like this, the camera rendered reality with an exacting detail in a matter of minutes. Learning it was also not as craft, as intensive a labor as painting was. Not to diminish photography, I love photography, but it was a different thing. So the field changed. Painting changed as a result. It shifted. Where did it go? 1890s, you have the rise of Impressionism. Believe me, this is not an art historian to talk, so just bear with me for a second. But you have the rise of Impressionism in the 1890s. Van Gogh, pieces like this. Over time, once this idea, this perspective, this technology, or not technology, but the lens through the world was discussed and viewed, it shifted again. You have Cubism. The 1920s gives rise to the New York schools and European schools of abstract expressionism in the 1940s and 50s, violent strokes like what you see. And now we have a new generation. We have new tools, new processes at play. Computer coding. This is nothing more advanced than a sorting algorithm, a bubble sorting algorithm, which if you have any background with computer science, you're probably familiar with. It's a pretty, it's an introductory assignment for many students where you sort bits and bytes according to certain values and it shifts them slowly, as you see here, all red bits and then orange and yellow aligned left and so on and so forth. These kinds of coding algorithms are the tools that are at play today. And they also, from them, come a variety of different art. So what you see here on the right is a piece from a Chicago-based artist. His name is Jason Salaval. The piece that you're looking at there is entitled Everything All at Once, and it is in fact Everything All at Once from one single movie, Apocalypse Now. All of the frames of that movie shot and then condensed into these concentric circles using a bubble sorting or custom software akin to a bubble sorting algorithm. Now, this is the heart of what I want to get into today, the influence of art and technology. There's a couple different parts to this talk, including my role in this, the work that I've done, where I intersect the state of the field now, different artists as examples, and how you can look at certain pathways for various students that you interface with. Now, as far as qualifications, my name is Chris Carruth, and as you can see from the screen, I am an artist, technologist, and educator. More importantly, though, I am also quite honored and privileged to be here with you today talking about this intersection of arts, technology, and education. Like I mentioned before, there are a couple things I want to go over, but it is important that I situate the conversation from that position. I am an artist and a technologist. I draw from this background. I've been practicing as an artist for about 10 years. Photography is the common medium of my practice, but for the last 6 or 7 years, I've increasingly incorporated creative coding, photogrammetry, 3D printing, installation, and site-specific sound work. I will share some examples towards the end. Now, I'm also approaching arts as an educator, and I've been teaching faculty with the University of Colorado for a number of years. I'm currently rostered with Information Sciences, which is within the College of Media, Communications, and Information. That field of information science is, it draws from data science, computer science, social sciences, and the humanities. So it ranges. And I think the most appropriate way to look at computer science and information science as an extension in many ways, is that it is a field of and with, meaning that your focus is not strictly on computer science or information sciences. It's and what you want to apply it to with what focus. So information or computer sciences for humanities, for health and informatics, for like biomedicine, for governance, sustainability, environmental sustainability, range of different things. Before that, I was doing work for a number of years as a network and system administrator. So I do draw from a number of different wells, definitely interdisciplinary. And I think that lends itself to art and to this talk. So yeah, I'm excited to share my thoughts at the intersection of arts and technology, as magical as it is. One thing that is at the heart of all this is that creativity in and of itself, it's a process. It's a way of thinking about the work and the process that we want to instill in students and young people, that will eventually get their project, right? The process gets you your your outcome, your product, if you will. So we want to instill in students a creative mindset, a way of thinking about the world. In many respects, for students, we give them an artwork, and what they may not realize right off the bat is that it's not so much the outcome that we're focused on. It's the way that they approach it, the labyrinth of thinking that they go through to get to an end result on this finished product on the other side. In the real world, when students are looking for jobs, what they have to offer in that light, it was not going to be so much just strictly a portfolio or a canvas, if they're a traditionalist, if you will, but it's that mindset. Because the biggest part of an arts-based education is arming students with the tools to think outside the box, to apply these technologies, some of that I'm gonna go over, in creative ways, using the tools around us, the tools of the day. So some other examples of contemporary creativity. Here's a great case in point. This is nothing more advanced, not to diminish this anyway, but nothing more advanced than drones with lights affixed to them. Now, I think most of you would probably agree that drones are fairly commonplace in today's society, so there's nothing that's really that advanced about utilizing them. And with lights, those have been around for some time now as well. So it's the combination of the two in conjunction with long exposure photography that gives you these patterns. And it must be said, from a computer science position, this is actually taking a bit of programming to have the drones go in a pre-programmed pattern or flight path, if you will, so they travel in a certain way that can be anticipated and then captured on camera. This same idea has been taken and been run with a number of different ways. There's one artist in particular whose name is Ruben Wu. Ruben Wu is based out of the West Coast. These are some of their latest works. So on the Salt Flats, I think this is near Joshua Tree. It's very much, man in nature, man's mark in nature. So there's some commentary here as well. But also, again, drones, lights, a bit of programming to make them fly in certain patterns. It's the creative application. That creativity is a process. And if nothing else, new technologies are allowing for these new processes. In particular, machine learning, artificial intelligence. They're drastically changing the nature of the creative process, calling into question, who's the actual author? Where is autonomy coming from in creation? Is it co-collaborative, or is artificial intelligence and machine learning, are they peers? So there's a lot of philosophical questions that come from this. Good meat on that bone to discuss with students, but either way, computers and computational media and creativity is playing a big role in fields ranging from music to painting to architecture. It is part and parcel of what we want to teach students. It's the and part, right? You learn computer science and you apply it to a variety of different ends that make sense for you, what your interests are, where they intersect, right? So in that light, what we're trying to do is get our students to understand that what they have to offer is actually special. It's something more substantive than that canvas, but it's that mindset, that way of thinking. So with contemporary tools in mind, we have the internet, and inescapably there is amazing work that is going on online on that platform. So this lovely jello mold is actually not the work, it's this website. So I don't know if you can hear this, you should be able to. The audio may not be coming through online, but this website, yellowtime.com, feel free to go there on your own. There you go. What's going on is it's JavaScript code, which is a web-based programming language, and you are able to do nothing more substantive than just that. Get the jello mode to wiggle, have that nice sound. Raphael Rosendahl, the artist who created this, he's got a few different websites like this. So I've got one here. I'm sorry, I couldn't resist. This one is also JavaScript code, and these fragments, if you click one, it changes the color, it changes the direction. This is all done with creative coding. Right? He wanted to, I can't say why he wanted to do this, but what he's effectively done is changed what interactivity can be online with the internet. And I think you can make a strong resonant case for all of these artworks and artwork in general, in terms of its value, is that the value in traditional work in like a capitalistic society exists over here, and it's usually tied to money. Value in artwork exists predominantly outside of that. And its value is in showing us new ways of thinking or being with the world and with self. And some of this work, I would argue, does just that. So you have this from Corey Archangel. Corey Archangel in the early 2000s, he was a child of the 80s and 90s. So he grew up with Nintendo and Super Mario Brothers. And if you played those games, you're probably familiar with this vision or these visuals, I'm sorry. But these are the clouds from Super Mario Brothers 1, if memory serves. And what he was able to do was go into the video game software and extrapolate just the bit of code that rendered the clouds and have that play on repeat in this installation kind of a setting. So he's hacking the video game to take just a bit of the visuals out and basically play that on loop to give you this kind of a scenario. Right? Jason Salavon, who I mentioned earlier, this is another piece of his work, and he's really well known for using software processes in his own design. From this one, again, every video frame of an input television that you see in the bottom right there, that television signal is then converted in real time to a circle of pure color and then represented as continuously radiating concentric stripes. So I don't have a GIF of this one, unfortunately, but you can imagine as this moves and pulses with a rhythm all its own and almost seethes and breathes. But it's code that creates that contemplative type of an experience, an embodied experience in many ways. With embodied experiences mind, you've got Jen Lewin's acoustic harp or the chandelier harp, and I'll let this one play here. Let's kind of skip along here. So this is an interactive instrument. How it's played is by passing your body through these low voltage lasers. You can see she's doing it with her hands. So the low voltage lasers shine from the chandelier harp to the ground, and it's much like plucking the string of a harp. Passing through the beam triggers custom circuitry and sensors to produce musical notes. So Lewin is the one who, working in conjunction with the team, fabricated the not just the design, but the software that controls how that those low voltage lasers interact, or when someone interacts with them and triggers them. She created all that together. You have this wonderful piece from Random International. I will mute this one. But this is over in LACMA, the Los Angeles County Museum of Art, as of 2 years back. What you have going on here is an entire room. You walk into the room and you'll notice that it is a deluge of rain coming down from the ceiling. So this is planned. There's not a fire. Don't freak out. But what happens when you're in this room is wherever you step, you stay dry. And how that is accomplished is through a variety of technologies. So for instance, there are pressure sensors in the ground. There are motion sensors in the wall. And both of these in conjunction with predictive algorithms determine where you could possibly step next with a reasonable amount of certainty. So it knows that maybe if you start walking this way, the pressure sensors, there's a chance 80% that you're going to go forward, you know, 70% chance you may go forward into the left, 30% chance that you'll step back. Either way, what controls the water in the ceiling, the release of it, is now going to be curbed at that point to ensure that wherever you go will remain dry. I'm sure there's some splashback from the ground, but by and large, you are dry, and that's what creates the experience or creates the art of it. But this cannot function, this vision, this reality, this embodied experience without coding, without creativity as a part of it. Anthony Antonellis, this is another piece here, and I won't, how he got this into his body is a whole conversation into itself, but let's just suffice to say he has an RFID or radio frequency identification tag embedded into his hand. Now, that RFID tag you can scan with a common phone, and when you do so, it pulls up a graphic like this. He changes the graphic every so often, but the art here is not so much the grotesquery of putting something in his body, or if you want to look at it from a different way, transhumanist cyborgism, but rather the art here, in my estimation, is that he is challenging the notion of what who the artistic gatekeepers are in a contemporary art fine art setting. So just like Raphael Rosendahl is putting his work online and disseminating it in that fashion, he is breaking down the traditional white cube gatekeepers. He is the gallery in this sense, a moving, living, breathing one. That's that in and of itself is amazing. You have this work as well. So I'm gonna go ahead and jump to this point. So this is painting based off visual feedback. So it's a combination of robotics, a robotic arm, as well as machine learning. So what's happening is the machine watches itself while painting and decides independently where to add new strokes. This way, paintings are created that are not completely defined by the programmer, but instead are the result of a visual optimization process. So it's like looking at itself or looking at the results as it's finishing and says, well, I need a bit more of this here, a bit there, more of this black there or white there to make this image a little bit better. So this is a combination of, you know, many different programmers. And I should mention that with much of this work, it is not just one individual working in isolation. The creative genius myth is just that, a myth, and actually a harmful one for creatives. This is work done in teams, usually using pre-established code, combining things. So there's an element of synthesis here as well. This one's good. So this is Emmy by David Cope, as you can see there. And I think you can hear that. You don't have to be a fan of choral music to appreciate this, as I hope not. So what you're hearing right now, Emmy by David Cope, is a machine learning algorithm that is essentially, the machine learning algorithm was, the input was the entire back catalog of Bach's choral music, just Bach. So it's got, I can't imagine how much, but all of that choral music was fed into this algorithm, machine learning algorithm, that is, that its output is what it interpreted that entire catalog. Here's what I think new choral music would be. So this music you're listening to was never written by Bach. It was never played in Bach's time. It wasn't written by any of Bach's contemporaries. It was written by a machine that analyzed all of Bach's content and said, this is what a new piece would look like. The applications for something like this are enormous. You know, if you're a fan of George R. R. Martin and the Game of Thrones series, for example, and you wanted to finally finish the last few books, you could effectively, theoretically anyway, feed all of the current books into a machine learning algorithm and get some kind of an output that would tell you what new books would be. Imagine where this goes 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 100 years from now. This is the state of the art at this point in time. So what does this mean for you? There's transformational potential that comes through the arts, whether it's a painted canvas, a directed camera, or the power of code. And that transformational potential, it comes not just in how the audience receives work, which is a key part of it, but also in the mindset of the person who's creating it. This is something that I think is inescapable. And as far as technologies that we really want to focus on in the classroom, and that we are at the collegiate level, and I would encourage at the K-12 level, probably more in high school, but game design platforms. So programs like Scratch, or at the high school level, Unity, Unreal Engine, allow for game design to be taught and then continued on into the collegiate environment. Photogrammetry. So this is big in terms of archaeology or architecture, where you can visualize a 3D structure, whether that's a small object like, say, a desk or a chair, if you're doing industrial design or any kind of design, really, fashion included. You can visualize that in an extended reality environment from 360 degree views, manipulate the object in that environment. Creative coding. I think you can make a very salient case right now that Having a measure of fluency in code, a level of digital literacy, is a foundational skill for every single person in the Western society at this point in time. It is the foundation of our economies, how we move through the world. And if we aren't teaching our students a basic literacy, we're doing them a disservice. How they use that goes back to what I was saying earlier. That's the and. What do they want to use it with, right? So coding and coding with, that's up to them. We want to empower them to do that, champion their endeavors. Angela Lansbury, or in this case, Angela Lansbury with virtual reality. A lot of this work, the game design or the photogrammetry and those objects, they go into AR, augmented reality, or VR, virtual reality environments that can be utilized. And because this is very timely at this point, most of this technology is part and parcel of what Facebook and Mark Zuckerberg's team has coined the metaverse. Now, this may seem new and cutting edge, but the idea of the metaverse has been around in the form of Web 3.0 for a number of years now. And the technologies are certainly established in their own right. So they've coined a word for something that has existed, pre-existed prior to them coining of the word. But they are looking, reading the tea leaves and seeing the confluence of a lot of these technologies, not just their confluence, but their maturation, and seeing that they want to be in front of it. I think it behooves us not to follow Facebook's lead or play into what they're doing by any measure, ethical issues there abound, but to notice that those technologies, to see what Facebook is seeing, that there is a confluence and there is a maturation. These are tools that can be used across a number of different fields and disciplines with a range of outcomes. So these are things that should be taught in a number of different ways. In addition to this, you know, this is what I ask my students often at the beginning of the semester. We're going to get into creative technologies, but what is it you want to do with this? What's your and? What's your with? And these are some of the common outputs from, or the outputs from a course last semester. And if you dumb this down at like an undergraduate curriculum level in like a first year program at the collegiate level, this could also be applied to a high school level curriculum as well. You start with a foundation of, you know, four things. Let's say classes that are focused on the digital humanities. What is the environment? What is like the metaverse? What are the ethical issues? How can we talk about these issues? So once we talk about them and we know what is at play, then we can start to apply those lessons with a more grounded, hands-on, project-based approach. And those experiential project-based classes would focus on, at the foundational level, imagery, text, and sound. From that, then, web-based coding, textual, that's more like graphic design and working with typographies and colors and fonts and imagery as digital imagery, still and motion. So it gives them a bedrock foundation that they can apply to web-based endeavors or elsewhere. Coding also comes into play in all three of these courses. It's embedded into that. From that foundation, they can apply this in upper level division courses that are more specific to their interests, whether that's human-computer interaction, again, informatics, information sciences, more hard level computer programming, data analysis, architecture, and so forth. But it's good to know what students want and where they want to move forward in these spaces, because there is a wealth of opportunity here, you know, and multiple studies bear this out, but there is a stable of established positions. If you see on the left here, in a number of different industries that they can also go into. So there's work in this. And that's often a common concern of students is what can I do with these degrees? You know, it's not just the arts anymore. It's computer science and art, computer science and creative expression or cultural expression. So there's a wealth of things I can do here. I know we're kind of winding down, so I'll try and take this last few minutes and talk a little bit about my path. As I mentioned, I've been at the intersection of arts and technology and education for a number of years. You know, where I started with arts and some of the work that I've done, it's with imagery. Like I said earlier, I draw deeply from photography. This image, if you see on the screen, it's behind me as well. There it is. It's a lot of my work is focused on place. So for me, it's technology and place as a vehicle or a catalyst for meaning, what place means to us in so many ways, specifically the American Southwest or the Desert Southwest. So one of the iconic images from the Southwest representationally is a horse. And in this case, I've taken an image of a horse's mane, and then used computer coding programming to go in and glitch the underlying code. So digital images in today's environment are ones and zeros, bits and bytes, the pixels. And if you go in and manipulate the code, you can effectively mess with, for lack of a better phrase, the aesthetic. And that's what you see here at the top right and the bottom left. So that's what's going on there. Another series of work deals with intervening in our relationship to the internet. So this is my inbox. And as you can see here on the right, I've opened up a JavaScript console, put in some code. When that code runs, what it does is it randomizes the size, shape, and color of every single HTML and CSS object on that website. This could be any website, from your inbox to Facebook to Amazon or whatever, what have you. It gives you this internet's interrupted presentation. It's intervening into our relationship. Very Mark Rothko-esque in terms of a presentation. The work presents well as like stills, photos. Again, I'm big into prints and photography, or as an immersive experience that is directly informed from what I've seen from Salavon's work or The Rain Room and other embodied experiences. What else? This is digital poetics presented on a light box. So my imagery, again, of the Southwest done in the wrapper, if you will, of a Gmail inbox. And then there's some poetry that goes along with that. Working with satellite imagery or composites. So this is using a bit of like GIS software to look at different sites as a struggle for cultural and symbolic meaning. Usually they're out the Southwest, but it can be anywhere, given satellite imagery. A parallel to this is the notion of a palimpsest, or something that's like a living archive that's continually contested and overwritten. Graffiti is a good case in point. While I'm in the Southwest or wherever, I usually take a slew of different photos, often as proofs, but the farther along I go in my own practice, the more I'm bringing those proofs into various programs like Unity, like I mentioned earlier, and running texture mapping algorithms to get extended reality objects that can then be manipulated and played with in a virtual reality or extended reality place. That's what you see here on the right. I mentioned this earlier, but a lot of that work does have a future in the sense of multiple disciplines, from the metaverse to architecture to a variety of different applications. So photogrammetry it's a really exciting space. You take a number of different photos of one object, and then those photos create a near lifelike presentation. And in education, these kinds of objects have helped us explore and understand, students that is, things as ranging as the surface of the moon, to the Titanic, to the Colosseum in Rome. Take your pick. With place in mind, these are computer generated, using custom software code, I've created a weighted average of the colors of a given scene. So photos that I've taken, then I run the algorithm to get a sense of what the colors are in that scene. Then I take those colors and I run another bit of code, and I make them move and breathe and pulse like what you see here. That's not the final bit of the work. I take that moving image, I run that through a projector and a room that's enclosed, in this case a C can or a canister. It's what you see here on the right, images of the process are on the left. So I'm giving color, in this case the color of the Southwest, of physical body to an extent, and creating an embodied experience while I'm away from the Southwest. If you can't tell out the window here, I'm actually up in Vancouver, British Columbia, but I still bounce between here, Boulder, Colorado, and Santa Fe, New Mexico. So I still have roots down there, deep roots. This allows me in some measure to reconnect with that, to be in that space to an extent. I'm a big fan of the Southwest. Like I said earlier, it's a place is a key part of my work. What that means to us, being lost, being in relationship to it. It is a continually contested, linked and shared vision, especially the Southwest, where its borders are, what it means to us in a number of different ways. So when I'm out there in the Southwest, I'm often taking field recordings. So I have a variety of different microphones, hydrophones, contact mics, geo mics. I'm playing with images like this. These are not mine. These are courtesy of the Wild Empathy Lab, Drs. Maria Lanton and Julie Andreev. Wonderful Maria Lanton, I should add. She's fantastic. But taking recordings in nature, in situ, and then from those recordings, bringing them into a spectrograph, which you see there on the left, and then running that spectrograph using Rhino, which is 3D software, 3D printing software, I should say, to create 3D objects of those sounds. You can actually physically hold them. That's what you see there on the right. And I should mention, the work on the right is not mine. That's actually Nick Kinnaird's. I don't have a visual example of mine at this time, so his is a standard. All credit to him. So yeah, that's the short of it. That's where we've come from, where we're going, where the conversation is extending to. It is, like I mentioned earlier, an honor and a privilege to be a part of that with you all. And I'm looking forward to answering questions on the panel or anything else that comes up. My contact information is here. Yeah, it's an exciting time to be alive. So, all right, thank you all.
All right. Thank you so much, Chris. What a very cool and engaging presentation and a way to see all of these different forms of art. So we're going to go ahead and start answering some of the questions. Attendees, you are welcome to put any questions that you have in the Q&A feature below. And Chris, I think the first question that I have for you is, could you tell us, we have a lot of K through 12 educators in the webinar. Could you tell us a little bit about your educational journey in like maybe middle school, high school, maybe what computing courses you've taken? Take us a little bit through that educational journey and into college.
Yeah, of course, I'd love to. And first off, I should say it was mesmerizing seeing how many times I said based off the live text transcription there. So I apologize to everyone for that. Yeah, my journey in terms of combining my career with art, and specifically art and computer science education, has been a little bit wayward. And I kind of mentioned this in the presentation, but I began my academic career, in high school, I was focused on a traditional pathway of courses, right? You had traditional social science courses. There were no coding at this point. This was in the late 90s. So coding was an elective if you wanted it, but it wasn't even an opportunity. So I really didn't interface with technology in a formalized classroom setting until I was in undergrad. And my undergrad is in business information systems. So the focus was on IS. Coding was a feature of the program, but not the focus of the program. It only really became later, like I mentioned in the presentation too, in the last 6 or 7 years that I really got turned on to the power of using creative coding and emergent technologies as a further vehicle to express myself. So I know I said this as well, but photography is where my practice is rooted, but photography, just like emergent technologies, they're subservient to the effort or the desire to create something, to say something, to explore something. The methods we do so change based off what we're trying to do and what's available to us. With students in mind, and this is where I think coursework can come into play, and especially educators, counselors included, it's encouraging those questions. If students are saying, I'm wrestling with this issue, I don't know how to approach it, doing so artistically has just as much validity as, say, a scientific method. And by that, I mean like an autoethnographic exploration of an issue of their choosing, how they react to something, how they emote to something, whether it's through drawing or writing, that's a foundational building block. There can be coursework that I think we should build around that. So things like I mentioned before, coding, JavaScript is a great language, processing, Python, R is more on like the statistics side, but some basic digital fluency and literacy that can serve our students in a number of different ways. And I mean, this is the information economy that we're in. So I think it behooves us to, across the board. Does that in general?
No, it definitely does. And what you said about asking about what issues the students, you said it at much more of a PhD level, the question, but something that we encourage counselors and educators to ask our students to really get under what they're interested in is by asking them what problem they'd like to solve. And so you really touched on that a lot.
Well, you know, like one of the key things about education, but I know we're in a group of educators right now, but this is probably apparent, and I apologize for that, but it's a relational aspect. We're building relationships with young people, young men and women, and we're carrying those relationships over a number of years. So in that, it's this cultivation of what are you interested in and how can we put you in a position to succeed? So building those relationships, individualizing their courses of study and the tools, or at least opening them up to a variety of different tools that are out there disposable and different pathways in that too. I think that's a part of this greater conversation is how do we individualize the conversation with students? How do we make the projects relevant to them as well? So I said this in the presentation too, but as far as IS and CS being and or with programs or degrees, you know, what makes it relevant to a student to want to go down an artistic pathway? So maybe you want to explore computer science and politics. What does that look like? How do you visualize an ongoing political divide, whichever you, the side of the divide you may find yourself on? How do you visualize that in an artistic way? How do you visualize the bonds where there's tension? There are ways to do that artistically. Some of the imagery that I shared before, Jason Salavon, for example, are doing similar work. So it's encouraging people, encouraging that growth.
Yeah, absolutely. I liked how you said about making an individualized experience for the students. And so educators, consider partnering art teachers and your teachers, put those projects together, right? Like, let the students express themselves the way that they would like to.
Yeah. Well, and it should be said too, it's iterative, right? The first time you do this, the first year, it may be a little bit rough if you're still trying to find out what resources are out there, what programs are out there, what the students' interests are. After the first go around, you iterate what worked, what didn't, you incorporate new methods. You have conversations like this where we all kind of talk together and grow and move together as well. So there's a fluidity that should be embraced too.
Yeah. So as we talk about some of these majors and careers, what does it look like as far as like salaries? How do we encourage our students that these are careers that they can also have a productive life outside of their career?
Well, the good thing, not to besmirch my contemporaries that are traditionalists in the art space, but the good thing about those that go into the art space with a computer science background or any kind of technological background is those skills are so transferable in a number of different ways, and they command salaries that are routinely higher than someone who is a traditionalist, I mean, like a sculptor or a painter. So you can still work in those spaces. I had a slide up earlier that showed all these like ancillary type of positions, say like with Facebook or with Google, that are looking for social media managers or graphic designers or working on virtual reality teams. A lot of that has to do with like branding and identity, and it's in the design space. Design is like the more business appropriate front end of art, and they both are, they're twins, if you will, in a field. They're both appropriate here, and I think they're both they both should be looked at as an art form, because at the heart they're both creative problem solving. So if you approach it like that, these fields can be very lucrative. And again, the graphic I showed earlier had some salaries attached to it, but they are, you can approach six figures after a couple of years. They're stable as well. This is, the economy is going in that direction.
Yeah, and absolutely, like something we talk about a lot is how the billions of untapped salary dollars that there are in computing careers and how they intersect with all these different career fields, and art is one of the growing ones. And the ability to, I think I was reading an article the other day about being able to restore historic art pieces using computers and being able to care for them. And then there was a question actually about the accessibility of computing and art. And I did see another research article about making colors a tactile experience for those that have an impairment of sight. Can you tell us a little bit more about that accessibility piece?
I absolutely love that question. I did put a comment in the chat section, but the idea of assistive technologies to help a variety of different individuals interface with art or experience the world differently. There are certainly artists and designers, I think is a more apt term for that, that are working on assistive technologies. One that I mentioned here was, it's a vest. And if you have a chance to go to the link now or later on for whoever's watching, you wear the vest and it will vibrate based off the volume and the proximity of someone's voice, if I understand it correctly. So the person who would be wearing it is someone who is hearing impaired. So this allows them a measure of interface with the world around them. Think like traffic, if they're in like a busy city, or in whatever way they want to engage with the auditory nature of the world that they may not have in their day-to-day life. So there is work that leans into that. The midi glove that I mentioned, it's almost